when I did have crabs.
Yes.
I was dating a girl.
From Red Lobster?
Close.
Okay.
She had a yeast infection.
Oh, so at least you got bread with the meal.
And we made crab cakes.
Yeah, that's called Golden Corral sex.
I'm not sure.
Just like a buffet.
Yeah.
You're riding down the Harland Highway.
All right, hold tight on the Harland Highway Show.
Harland Williams.
How you doing?
Great. Are you all geared up? This has to be like close.
I'll get it there. I've done this four times.
Is this number four?
Five, maybe. Okay. Just let me have my moment.
Yeah, I'm going to just let you settle in.
No, you should have me settling in when it happens, if you're smart.
I know, but I want you to kind of breathe.
Are we rolling?
Yeah, we're rolling.
See, then you already lied to me.
I didn't lie. I just was evasive. I didn't answer specifically.
So already we started in a hole, and now I'm...
We're in a bit of a hole, I think.
I'm wondering what we kind of discussed. I wasn't comfy yet, and you said, I'm going to try and let you get comfy before we start.
Well,
and the truth was, you had already started.
Well, I think I started the minute I sat down, because what I'm sending you is a visual sign. As you noticed, I've dressed very eclectic today, because I thought we would talk about art.
We can get to art. We can
like
we can
I'm very
talk
artsy.
About anything. There's
I'm very
a lot.
Artsy.
That's nice.
Like kind of colorful, and I got the
I
hat.
Like, I do enjoy art. I do some sketching at times. So
you do?
I'm sure we can get to that eventually. I'm not ready.
You're not ready yet.
Immediately.
Settle in. Have a drink. Maybe I'll have a
sip. You had told me we were going to take a moment to get comfy, mm-hmm. and that wasn't really...
Oh, you know, this will help. This song, the theme song always soothes. It gets people in the zone. Ladies and gentlemen, you're on the Harland Highway podcast. And I'm going to fade it really slow just to get the vibes going, get the podcast vibes going. I think I just winked at you, which was really weird.
I took it. I'm just...
I know, but I'm still
getting comfy. I'm still dealing with your deceptiveness at the top.
I know, but look how slow I'm fading the music. Like, slower than I ever have before.
I can't tell because I don't have the...
Oh, you don't have the Tinker
but
Nuts
I'll
on.
I don't know if you clean them.
Yeah, we don't clean them. Why would we?
So
everyone likes wax.
That's kind of why I don't wear them.
Yeah, there's a big wax residue on there.
So that's kind of... Probably why.
You know how Gwyneth Paltrow made like a candle, like a Paltrow scented candle?
I'm aware that she did some candle work, and I believe the smell was vaginal.
Yeah. So what I do is I collect the wax from all the guests and make like podcast guest candles. So those probably smell a little bit like Pauly Shore, Kevin Nealon, and Cher.
Yeah, that's... That's not what I want on my ears.
Yeah.
My ears, I like to keep them clean.
Yeah.
I already have tinnitus. So
oh, God. That's like the ringing in the ear, the constant.
It's constant ringing.
Is it happening right now?
Right now, 24/7. So if you hear that, it's me.
Wow.
But it's always ringing. There's a thing called habituation where the brain has decided that it's not a threat, but it's always ringing.
Like, if you could put the tinnitus at a volume, what's the volume right now? And maybe I'll use the theme music as a guide. Like,
okay.
What's the volume of your tinnitus?
Well, I can't hear that because I'm not putting the disease.
No, I'm doing it. You can't hear, but I'm going to do it for the viewers.
Okay, well, then you're going to have to guess. It's kind of, imagine a car alarm in the next room.
Wow.
Very loud. I can't even hear that.
No, I know, but I'm kind of demonstrating for our viewers what your tinnitus might be like.
Oh, but it's constant. It's
you're
going up and down. This
yeah.
is just a high-pitched.
On a scale of 1 to 10, what's the volume?
Is 10 how loud?
It's a 10?
No, is 10 how loud would a 10 be for volume?
Like if you're listening to your stereo in your bedroom, you're listening to Boston or Kansas, whatever you listen to, Bay City Rollers, you're in your bedroom with your stereo, and you turn it up, What's the volume at?
Not quite full volume. I'd say an 8 out of 10.
So you have an 8 going on in your head the whole time?
Constantly. So when you say, get comfortable, basically...
It's an insult.
It's just me trying to find out where I am and
breathe
in the moment and just be here.
What kind of ringing is this? Like a telephone ring, or is it like a fire alarm or a car alarm?
I had mentioned car alarm.
So it's like
a
that
moment ago.
Beep, 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 beep.
But without all that, just a straight and then. So you combine those.
Whoa.
And that's what's in my head 24/7.
Come on. Even when you sleep?
Even when I sleep. I used to sleep with a white noise machine, but I eventually just got married and that replaced the white noise machine.
Now it's the wife noise.
Every night I go to bed and she starts talking and and I'm out pretty quick.
And then
I wake up, it's still going.
But do you still get the...
I still get it all, man.
So at least you get the wife.
I still get the occasionally by accident. That's just if she has possibly leaned there while she's asleep. If she's asleep and she's in the area, I'll do the rest. She won't even know.
Oh, you'll make love to her in her sleep?
Of course, man.
Really?
That's love.
Do you ever worry about getting that eye gunk all over you, though? You know those crusty things in the eyes?
I don't
get it all over your weenus?
They're not closed. You mean her gunk?
Her eye gunk all over your weenus. Because it's sort of crusty. It's like it's almost like a kidney stone.
Hers is always so crusty
that
it's just there always. There's a crust.
It drops in your pubes.
This doesn't drop. It's always there.
Always got eye crust.
Always. Her eyes are always closed.
Hmm.
Tired. You know, she's up late.
Wow.
So that's life, man.
Has she ever woken up in the middle of one of these lovemaking sessions?
No, and that's the beauty of it.
How aggressive is this on a scale of 1 to 10?
I'm pretty aggressive.
And...
She just takes it and
she just lays there.
She thinks she's sleeping. It's wonderful. And then sometimes she'll say, "Oh, I thought we were going to, you know, get it on last night. And you didn't wake me." And I said, "We did." And I didn't wake you. So it works out pretty great.
Wow. Is there a term for that? Is it called sleep intercourse or sleep?
I don't really.
Sleep a course?
I'm not aware of terms. I just know that when she's asleep, it feels better to me.
What about nighty night fuck?
Yeah, there's not a lot of dialogue.
No, I'm just trying to find a title for it.
That's up to you. I
sleepy buys fuck.
I don't even want to name it in case it ever comes up in court.
Sandman sex.
Now, you're looking to get a response from the planet?
No, I'm just... Look, I have viewers, and sometimes they need... about 8, and they need visual cues sometimes. And sometimes when you're at...
Look at that. That's the first time I've just zeroed in on them.
Oh, yeah.
Let them take it.
Yeah.
Okay. It's just the eyes have gotten greener, and
what's
crazy is last time we were here, I think we talked about my beauty.
Yeah, that's true.
And... I don't know how.
Yeah.
That was maybe 4 or 5 months ago. I'm back pretty too soon.
Yeah.
But I'm getting better looking, and I think they can adjust.
Yeah.
The hair is strong.
Looks good. Looks good. And little coif.
The key is to just keep the chin up.
Chin. Little subtle stubble, I call it.
I've been filming, so I've been a 9 on the mustache.
Yeah.
And a 4 everywhere else.
Yeah.
So I go 4 to 9 so I can repeat it before I go to bed at night.
Now, when you're doing the sleepy time fuck.
Oh, we can get back to that.
Yeah. I just wondered, does she snore at all?
She's not really snoring. She's just out. She's a deep sleeper.
Okay. Is there a sleep apnea mask on her face or anything?
No. It's just the face is pretty deep in the pillow.
Okay.
Because we have a child.
Okay.
And I don't want to wake the child up.
No.
Because when the child sleeps, I can imagine she doesn't exist.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so when the when the child is asleep, I'm single, and I see a woman next to me.
Yeah, your wife.
I don't think of her as my wife at that moment.
Oh, you, it's like a, now she's a fantasy leg.
Just like a blow-up doll that's warm.
Yeah, yeah, a warm blow-up doll.
And that I didn't have to really blow up. It's just there.
Warm like a quiche Lorraine or warm like
I don't know the language of quiche.
Well, I feel like I'm gauging a lot of meters, but is she like warm like a nice quiche Lorraine or would she be warm like a blint?
For some reason, she sleeps warm. She runs she runs hot. Enough for penetration.
Yeah.
I don't know why you're laughing at love, but
no,
there
just,
has to be enough warmth for
penetration.
Penetration. Otherwise, she could wake up.
So wait, just scientifically, medically,
of course.
If she's cold, there's a contraction where it's hard to open the garage? If her body's cold.
That's not my department.
Right.
Mine is penis.
Yeah.
That's what I'm working with.
Right.
But so if there's an erection.
Yeah.
If it's erecti.
Yeah, erecti.
I can go right in, man.
But you said if she's warm.
But she seems to sleep warm. I've never seen her cold.
Huh.
It's always a pretty smooth entrance.
Have you ever?
Enough to not wake her.
Wow.
So that's love. I mean, that's the best part of marriage. If you can just treat her like a blow-up doll. No dialogue.
Yeah.
And in the morning, she says, why didn't we? And you say, we did. I will say this.
Yeah.
As a gentleman.
Okay.
I do clean her up after.
How so?
If I have left a puddle of love, me.
Yeah. Yeah.
I go get a rag.
A rag. Like a garage rag?
It's similar.
Yeah.
I will say it could live in the garage.
Yeah.
It's in the house.
Okay.
But this rag should not be.
Yeah.
I wet it a little.
Okay.
Cold.
Yeah.
I'd like it to be warm.
Yeah.
But we have an electric water heater.
Yeah.
That takes a long time.
To warm up. So just
when I say a lot, maybe 20 minutes.
Oh, God.
So by then, I feel I'm losing sleep.
Yeah.
So there's a little rag that's always close.
Yeah.
It just kind of stands in the corner. I don't even hang it.
Yeah.
And
rubber cold.
I wet it, and then I just kind of wipe her up. And I'll say
what
this.
What a gentleman. Seriously.
I pull the underwear back up as far as I can without moving her.
Like a wedgie?
No, I said as far as I can. It kind of gets to the thigh area.
Okay.
But I do get them down.
Yeah.
It starts with there's panties on.
Yeah.
And I kind of move them down.
Yeah.
And it's easier to move them down than to push them up.
Yeah.
So after I've completed what maintains the marriage, I pull them up a little. Because in the morning she said, I thought we were going to have sex. And I said, we did. She's like, why are my underwear
panties,
or the garment? Why is my panties still on?
Yeah.
And I said, they are, but look where they're at.
They're higher.
Or lower than they should
be. Oh, lower, lower.
They're on her leg, the thigh
area. Oh, they're down. Okay. Yeah. Okay, I misread
get them
it.
I couldn't get them back up.
Got it.
So I pull them down enough so that I can see the target.
Yeah, target.
I get in there. She sleeps warm.
Now, you say she sleeps warm. Do you ever put on the infrared goggles and look for the thermal heat and pretend you're having love with a desert?
I don't like things that, could keep me up.
Yeah.
So there's no goggles. I just need sometimes to get the poison out.
Well, I just thought, you see these, you ever see the helicopters at night and they're following cars or criminals running through backyards? It's like thermal imaging. And I thought if she's running hot, you could put those on and almost have like Silence of the Lambs sex.
I will say,
and then you see her body and the fumes.
I know she's running hot.
Yeah.
Because the penis penetrates smoothly and to the point where when there's a little heat from the woman, even a little, the ego of the man gets involved and you feel that you're exciting her.
God.
But luckily she runs hot. So I'm pretending she's excited and then I just do it up two or three pumps because I'm an edger.
How long does this last?
I just said two or three pumps.
So, oh, wow.
I'm...
Wow.
You don't know that this about me. I don't think we've ever talked about it. And I wanted to mention it as I was driving here. I don't know if you have time.
I have time, buddy. This is good.
And this will all tie in.
Okay.
And maybe toward the end we can get to photography, but...
Okay.
You know, no, this is key. Because I know you brought up you're in your art theme.
That's okay. Look, when everyone wants to have a conversation about chivalry and being a gentleman, I'm all in because I think it's a lost art form. I think the art of lovemaking is lost. And for you to come in here and throw this at my audience and
reinvigorate. I don't even know how it came into play.
I don't either, but
who when
cares?
I got here, I said, I'm going to just be open, as I say, present, vulnerable, to see where this goes. I like coming up here, Harlan, because I don't really talk to people much.
I
don't do a lot of these podcasts.
I know. We're honored.
I like that we're honored. You're a block from me, so I can drive here. Mm-hmm. So when you say, hey, will you come up? I'm like, yes. And I do it because in case of an emergency in life, I want to be able to ask for help.
Oh, explain.
So, well, if I'm always home alone, not talking.
Yeah.
In case of an emergency, I wouldn't really be able to say, hey, can you help or hand me a rope? But if I practice talking to you, this is, I feel, practice. We're talking. So in case of an emergency, I'd feel comfortable to say to you or anyone.
Okay.
I even talk to the homeless often to practice.
You do?
In case I need something from someone who has a home.
Oh, that makes sense. But have you ever been in one of those homeless tents?
I have.
What's in? I've always wondered what's in there.
Clutter.
But what? Like what? Because I have a feeling my dad's couch in one of those things.
Name it.
What did you see in there?
Name anything that you can think of in life.
I'm missing a lawnmower.
In there.
What the F?
Name something else.
My neighbor has a fake leg that's gone missing.
I've seen a fake leg.
In the tent.
Yes. And I've been in a few, and each one has almost the same shit. Legs and lawnmowers.
Wow.
So, I've been in a tent.
Wow.
Homeless. I still call them homeless. A lot of people call them less fortunate or unhoused.
Yeah. Or tent stealers.
Tent stealers is fine, but
because I don't think if you're homeless, you can afford a $700 tent.
To some of them, to me, I call lucky.
Oh, why?
There's no wife. There's no mortgage. Seem happy.
Yeah, there's no commitment. There's the man watching over them.
Yeah, they're in there reading. A lot of them read by
candlelight.
There's a lot of books in one of them I went to.
Wow.
Kind of a library feel with limbs.
There's some about a guy with three teeth and Charles Dickens, it's just romantic.
That's why books were written. You know, when Dickens was writing that, that was probably a dream.
To be in a Coleman tent with urine-soaked pants and four teeth.
Leaning on a lawnmower. I mean, that's why you're right.
Tom Sawyer. Yeah, that's why you're right.
You think you want
you're
some rich guy and in a leather chair looking at a view. Oh, you want someone that's covered in shit.
Yeah, you want a guy with a grocery bag on his head, a Subway sandwich sticking out of his belly button.
Makes me want to write. Makes me want to finish something.
A dog that's got so much hair, it's a cat.
Oh, man.
And a foot that's twisted backwards.
So can we get back to...
Sorry, go ahead.
I just want to finish this up.
Yeah,
I don't know,
is this the lovemaking thing still?
It all ties into that because you asked how...
Go ahead.
I told you... two or three thrusts.
Thrust.
And I'm completed.
Describe a thrust, though. Is that like...
Well,
that...
I'm 6'5".
Oh, wow.
So, and I'm packing quite a punch. I have a lot of penis.
Can we say how much?
I don't need to.
They
more
love...
more information.
But they love
depending
penis
on my,
sizes.
Depending on my mood, it's a monster.
Like, can we... For them, they love sizes.
8 to 10 inches, depending on mood.
It's
one of the reasons I've never worked.
That's like a northern pike.
Or cared about life in general. Because at the end of the day, when you're packing quite a punch, you're going to win sometimes.
Did you say 8 to 10?
Mostly 8, depending on my mood.
Yeah.
But it can telescope to, I've seen it at 10.
Wow.
Which is very, it's TV time.
Wow. If she's running real hot, you're getting a 10.
But I cannot get that all in.
Oh, no, you can probably only go up to, what, 4.5, and then the rest is just out in the cold.
The rest is
it's
just...
like the Flintstones cat.
The rest is just punishment. So when you say how big of a thrust, I would say 4 to 6.
Wow.
And that's pretty deep thrust.
Let me ask, it's just big.
But I want to get to why it's so quick.
Okay.
It's like having a Ferrari that doesn't work.
Okay.
But the reason it's so quick...
Okay.
Sometimes I have places to go.
You got stuff to do.
But also, and this is going to tie into what I wanted to mention, but I am an edger.
What does that mean?
I'm always edging.
I don't know what that means, and neither do they.
I think a lot of them do. I'm always near ejaculating.
You're at the edge of ejaculate.
I do not masturbate, Harlan.
You don't.
I save my chi, my life force, for special occasions.
Your seed?
My seed. Just the shine on my pee is constant.
The albino polywogs.
Whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
It's that life force. It's the shine.
So it's
I'm always leaking. And let me tell you. So when I say 2 or 3 thrusts, that's if I'm quick. I have to get it in there to even thrust.
Yeah.
Because the minute I see an open area ready for penetration, I start to ejaculate.
Oh.
So I'm always clamped. Mm. So I try not to watch pornography.
Yeah, don't. You
because
don't need
it encourages suffering.
Yeah.
Most of the women don't want to be there.
Yeah.
And you can pretend they do, but it's a sad existence. A lot of them are sex trafficked. A lot of them are doing it to support drugs, and most die early.
Some of them even are asleep.
Yeah, this is true. There is a whole sleep porn genre that I avoid because, once again, I avoid porn. But when I do watch it, I don't masturbate.
Yeah.
So I'm always close.
You're close. You're like a blue heron just about to
always
get a frog.
And that's edging. So that's why, that's why it's pretty quick. There's probably a lot of edgers out there right now. But I wanted to mention...
Yeah, please.
Because last time we were here, we talked about an orgy in Parma. We talked about...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's right.
Ferrari sent me there.
Yeah, that's right.
To do some jokes at a...
Yeah.
It was just a corporate event.
Corporate, yeah.
And then an orgy broke out.
Yeah, I remember you told me.
And we talked about that, and I continued doing what I do.
Yeah.
I stayed in the pocket.
Stayed there.
Got my sea legs.
Yeah.
And... a lot of things happen. We don't need to get into it.
Nope.
They can listen to the other podcast.
That's right.
But afterwards, after that podcast, I'd say 1,000 people asked me, did you nut? Did you at least nut at this orgy?
Okay. Yeah. And probably.
Because I had said I'd gotten involved and I'd handed out water. And,
yeah.
But I did nut twice.
Okay.
And the first one was in my pants right when it started.
Okay.
Because why?
Because you're nuts?
Because I'm an edger. We just
edger, sorry.
We just had this conversation.
You're an edger.
The minute an orgy breaks out, and if you're an edger, the train leaves the station pretty quick.
Yeah.
So I nutted almost immediately. But I kept doing my comedy. So that was the first nut.
Was there a big stain on your crotch?
Low.
Pardon you?
A low strain. Low.
A low stain.
Stain.
You said strain.
There was a strain and a stain.
A stain.
Because I'm packing a punch.
So it was...
You said crotch.
Yeah, it's down by your knee.
I'm saying
low
stain.
Got it. Yeah.
Wow. And the second one, the valet blew me. So the second nut was actually, they couldn't find my car. So I had one nut in my pants.
Yeah.
And the other, the valet.
The valet? Do you remember his name?
I don't, but there was nudity. It could have been a man or a woman. But in that environment, in Parma, the lighting,
you
just run with it. But I will say this as
fast.
A friend, and we can move on from edging.
Sure.
if you're within 2 feet of a woman,
okay,
and you're having good conversation and there's eye contact, like this, I'm looking at whoever I'm talking to. Yeah. It's pretty straightforward. If you're within 2 feet and you nut in your pants because you're an edger, it counts as sex.
What?
A lot of people do not know that. It counts as sex. I have had I've had sex with at least 500 women that don't know it.
Yeah. Edging.
Edging. Because I'm there and it happens. And Hugh Jackman, I believe.
Hugh Jaculate is more like it.
Exactly. I was in an elevator with Hugh Jackman. There was an edge going on. I made it 3 floors. And then I nutted in my pants.
Over Hugh Jackman.
That's who I was talking to. Wow. But here's a loophole.
That's called Wolverine squirt.
Exactly. But here's the loophole, because you're on the right thought pattern.
Okay.
Hugh Jackman looks similar to me. Now, you look to them like it's not true, but enough in my mind where it may have been masturbation.
What was?
The nut.
Oh, okay.
Because I was looking at what I thought was myself.
I see.
And then I realized I look like Hugh Jackman if Wolverine had rabies.
Or SARS.
Hugh was feral. So that's... So that's kind of the edging world. And a lot of women like it when men edge. They don't talk about it. But if a man edges and nuts in his pants on a date, it's one less thing for a woman to have to deal with at the end of the night.
It probably takes the stress off the date because now there's no sort of expectation of physical togetherness.
Exactly, brother. And also, this might come into play in your world, but I want to always be ready
to
in case a woman changes her mind and doesn't want to have sex.
Right.
Where if she were to say, I don't think we should maybe have sex.
And then you just have it anyways. And I say,
it's a little late.
Yeah.
You should have maybe told me before you took your jacket off at dinner.
Yeah.
So that's who I am. I don't know what put us on that.
No, no. Well, now
tangent, and I apologize.
No, this is good because you got me wondering about the physics of this sleeping thing. You kind of do it at your own whim. You've got 10
she
inches.
She has given permission. It's not... I'm not taking it against her will.
Right.
She has always kind of said...
It's a marital agreement.
It's kind of always said, if I'm asleep and you need a release, you can go ahead.
What does the drywall look like at the head of your bed? Like, how many holes are in the drywall from her head?
I told you, the face is in a pillow.
Right, but if you're behind it, even
I'm
in a pillow, you're
going down.
But her head's got to be going forward.
I'm going down, not...
Oh, you're drilling down, not forward.
Straight down. Wow. So these are things that...
Wow.
And she's also, I don't want to wake up a child. I've told you that.
Is the child sleeping in the room or in their own room?
The child has their own room.
Okay.
I'm doing pretty good in life.
Because you got to wonder if the child's in the other room in the crib... And
no
mummy's
crib.
Head
the
smashes
child,
through
the child has made it to almost 6 years old.
Okay.
So we've gotten through the crib.
So the child's laying in their own bed. In the next room, mummy's head comes crashing through the drywall.
Well.
The kid wakes up mommy, and mommy's just like...
Asleep.
Does the kid ever think mommy's dead and somehow got smashed through the wall?
I don't think that really comes into play.
Well, it could. Child, I think it will.
The child... Does
the
talk about
child,
death.
The child.
The child does talk about death a lot. So
really?
I don't think she'd really mind too much.
A dead mother coming through the wall?
But I tell you, I go down. You are stuck on the visual.
I know, but when you, yeah, okay. But I'm pitching, if you've got 10 inches and you're going down, I'm
mostly
picturing,
8. I said 10 is rare.
I know,
rare.
But that'll go right through the mattress and into the floorboards.
10 is rare, my friend.
But you ever get stuck in the floorboards and you can't get out?
I don't go that deep. I'm not in there long enough to really deal with furniture. It's just I just get it over with pretty quick. It is a pretty good life.
What a life.
And I must say, I'm against sex if she's awake.
Yeah. You don't want
her. I don't really want her to get anything out of it.
Yeah, I get it. So it's a lot of business.
It's kind of making love for spite.
Yeah. Wow.
But I do clean her up. I do use that rag.
Has she ever reciprocated where you've been asleep and she's nighty-night fucked you or whatever it's called?
I think once there was, I don't want to be waking up. I'm sure I pushed her off.
Okay.
I don't want that sort of behavior. If I'm asleep, I want to continue on the dream. Especially if I'm dreaming about somebody else.
Having sex with someone else?
Yeah, I'm not.
You don't want to wake up and see your own wife on you when you're like having sex with Farrah Fawcett in a dream.
Yeah.
Then you slowly open your eyes and it's your wife. Oh, God forbid.
Man, see? I mean, that's smart. Why I come up here. There's, you know, we think alike. It's fun. It's fun to just laugh about it.
Well, I'm glad we got through that quick opening bit on our way to talking about art. And I know you wanted to discuss art.
I didn't really. Maybe a month ago I said, hey, if we ever do this again, we should talk about art.
But we don't have to.
But art is a part of my life.
Why?
Well, first of all, was it in Parma? Did I mention that I was not allowed a selfie?
No.
I was not allowed a selfie at the orgy. I wanted...
Oh, an orgy selfie. Yeah.
But I always have a pen.
Okay.
So I did a sketch.
So you could...
Of the orgy. So I'm always...
Okay.
And maybe this can tie into art, but to draw an orgy
is
pretty easy.
It is?
And you're an artist in a way.
Yeah.
You close your eyes.
Yeah.
And then you just feel what you're seeing in your mind. And nothing has to match up. And an orgy is just...
It's sort of chaos.
It is chaos. So you do this and a limb, and then at the end you draw a tit, which is a circle, and then you just dot it.
Yeah.
And then I sneeze on it.
Wow. So I'm picturing a Jackson Pollock with a tit sticking out.
With sneeze on it.
Wow.
Which represents an ejaculate. So once again, it ties to that.
Hey, everybody. Check out my merchandise at harbling.com. Yeah, most people just slap some letters or images on a t-shirt or a hoodie. But not me. Yours truly. Guess what? I draw my own designs at harbling.com. You can see tons of my hand-drawn t-shirts. You can either buy the original or you can buy a print. And man, oh man, wear them loud and proud. I love making these designs for you guys and keeping it personal. So check out the whole catalog. We got hoodies, we got coffee mugs, we got... T-shirts, you name it, it's there at harbling.com. Get your Harland original design, wearable art at harbling.com today. And thank you for your support, and I'll just keep the groovy images coming.
Now, have you seen an orgy lately?
Not lately.
Here's what I can kind of...
Okay.
Describe it to you. If you've ever been driving down an alley late at night
and you see
20 or 30 discarded mannequins.
Right.
Just piled on each
stacked.
Other
yeah.
in a dumpster or near it.
Yeah.
That's kind of the feel for an orgy.
That would seem a little rigid to me, though. There's no bend in a mannequin. It seems a little stiff. Was the orgy you were at with people with rheumatoid arthritis, or was it an arthritic?
There was a lot of stiffness. There wasn't a lot. Mostly flat.
I think you were at an arthritis convention and an orgy broke out.
That's fine. Yeah. It doesn't matter what caused the...
Well, the good thing about being at an orgy with people suffering from arthritis is you don't have to worry about anyone being stiff.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah, so, wow.
But orgies are interesting. Do you know this?
Yeah.
Here's something I learned. You are not allowed to spray at an orgy.
Like bug spray?
You're ejaculate.
Oh, okay. Okay, my bad.
You are wearing condoms.
Because if I was at an orgy, I'd definitely get some Raid or Off.
Of course, you'd have to...
before I jumped into the meat pile.
I think they're sprayed before they get there.
Yeah, like you don't want...
Because it's a villa.
Yeah, I'm using Black Flag.
You don't want to bring bed bugs into a villa.
Fuck,
and some of these people looked a little suspect.
Yeah, I'm thinking like dung beetles and rhinoceros beetles.
But there's
no
spraying.
But as an edger, that's got to be very hard for you.
I edge in my pants.
But at an orgy, you're naked.
I was not.
You were the only guy at the orgy with clothes on.
I did not take my pants off.
For the orgy.
I stood on the stage and continued comedy.
Well, the orgy was at your feet.
Yes, I told you. That's why I stayed in my lane. But you are not allowed to spray unless the woman says okay. No spray without the okay.
No spray, no stay. Wow.
And I saw this. I saw one guy get the nod from a woman.
A Chinese guy?
Possibly.
Well, you said one guy?
Maybe. I see where you're going there. They're going to love that.
No, I didn't know you knew anyone's name.
I didn't.
Well, who's
no
one guy?
Name tags. There was a gentleman. One gentleman got the nod from a woman.
Who, one guy?
One guy. Maybe an Asian.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I said
so
at the beginning.
So you know him.
Yeah, one guy.
I circled back because now it becomes clear.
Okay.
So one guy.
Yeah.
The Asian.
The Asian one guy, yeah.
Got the nod from the woman.
Okay.
And he gave her the look that said, really?
Wow.
And he took off the condom and sprayed and seemed very happy. It's like winning the lottery. And then another guy took off his condom.
Took off one guy's?
No, one guy's is already off.
Wow.
He took it off himself.
Who's the second guy?
I did not know him, but I saw that he was involved in this corner. He took off his condom to spray, and she said, not you, only him.
One guy.
Only him.
So second guy, no. One
was
guy,
not
go.
Allowed.
Wow.
And he looked sad. To see someone's feelings hurt at an orgy is something to behold. An orgy is usually just a love fest, but to see someone sad because he wasn't allowed to spray.
Wow. And what do they do when they take the condom off? Where do you put that in the middle of an orgy? Where does it go?
I did not see. Maybe in the couch, in a cushion.
Wow.
But I did come back the next day.
Okay.
I left my jacket.
Oh, God.
And I came back the next...
At an orgy.
And I came back the next day to the villa in Parma looking for my jacket.
And was it there?
There was a lost and found.
Oh, God.
With mostly socks and cock rings.
Wow.
So that was what was in the lost and found and my jacket.
There were cock rings all over your jacket?
Near it. It was a pretty big lost and found. But
how many cock rings are we talking?
There was probably 10 and a lot of random socks.
There were 10 cock rings? That's enough for a shower curtain where I come from.
Well, if I had known you were short, I would have brought some cock rings. But here's the interesting thing.
Okay.
The cleanup at a villa, at a Parma orgy, they burn... most of the furniture.
They do?
It looked like they were pulling things out and just burning them. So that's, which makes sense. If there was an orgy in my house, I'd level it. I'd burn it.
Does a... I've never asked this question, and maybe you know, because you...
I don't know what I know. I'm just...
You seem to know a lot about this.
I just know because I was there, and I'm an edger, and...
Well, as an edger, you might
we started talking about it last time, so I remembered more about it.
If the seed, the semen...
The joculon...
gets into fabric, like on a couch or whatever, is it a flammable substance? Is there any...
Man, I don't...
Will it go up... Like if you dropped a cigarette butt on an orgy-soaked semen couch.
I do not know. I do not know if ejaculate is flammable. That's okay. A great question.
I think it is. I think it's valid.
I do know this.
Okay.
Those blue fluorescent lights.
Yeah.
If you flash them on my pants at any time.
Oh, you'd probably go blind.
It looks like 4th of July.
More like the Northern Lights.
Exactly. Or the Southern.
Wow.
So that's kind of who I am.
You know, you got me wondering about this flammable thing now. Well, have you ever put a cigarette butt out in the hole of your penis?
No, but I will say this as a friend.
Okay.
I thought about it once.
Okay.
I had what's called scabies.
Oh, God.
It's when crabs...
Favorite episode of Fraggle Rock.
Yeah. I haven't seen that. I don't have a TV. It's when a crab lays an egg under your skin. And I believe there was a scabie in the tip of my pee hole.
Oh.
And I thought about... Oh. I wasn't a smoker, but I thought about just a match. Something where I would burn...
Burning it.
And I didn't.
Oh, my God.
I went and jumped in the ocean and really scraped. And then eventually you get a thing called, I believe, quail.
Oh, that's delicious. If it's prepared properly.
Yeah, I didn't drink it.
A good quail is... Oh, what did you say?
I believe quail.
Oh, I thought you said quail.
But quail might also work.
Under glass, you can't beat it. With crab?
Oh, man.
Well, let's thank you. Oh, please. Was there an addendum?
You mentioned, well, yeah, but you mentioned
more.
Something.
I think there's more here. Yeah.
When I did have crabs.
Yes.
I was dating a girl.
From Red Lobster?
Close.
Okay.
She had a yeast infection.
Oh, so at least you got bread with the meal.
And we made crab cakes.
Wow.
Which at the time, $14.95 a pound.
Oh.
So we had a good little business going to the point where I did not want to get rid of the crabs.
Yeah, that's called Golden Corral sex.
I'm not sure.
Just like a buffet.
Yeah, so college.
Wow.
Which could lead
How
us-
does one eliminate the crabs?
Quail.
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 Wait, what is quail?
It's a lotion that you rub on your fur.
Okay.
And they dye, and then it gives you a little comb with them. And you comb out the crabs and the eggs. It's called quell, I believe.
How do you spell that?
I believe K-W-E-L-L. I don't...
K?
I believe quell.
No, it's not Q.
No, but I believe I remember seeing the letter K.
K-E-L-L?
I believe K-W, quell.
Quell, okay. I don't need any.
I know.
I'm just asking.
I kept it for a while.
You did?
So you're itching. Is that because of the conversation?
No, I don't have crabs.
Okay. Because if you do, I know someone with a yeast infection if you want to get into business.
I'd love that.
This happened in college, where I took my first art class.
Oh, speaking of art, I do portraits.
Okay.
Have you heard of street art?
I have not.
Okay. Well, there's street. I do priest art and I do portraits. Father Fazakary from St. Timothy's.
Now, did you do that?
Yeah, I did this. It got a, he, I don't know what was going on with him, but just as he got a little, asked him to keep a straight face and was a little, I don't know what was on his
mind.
That
is beautiful.
Thank you.
Now, did you learn, was that from college?
Yeah, I learned that in college, priest art.
I.
At DeVry.
I was, Can I tell you about how I was kicked out of my first art class, or do you have some more art talk?
When you say kicked out of an art class,
yes.
That is art talk. Hello.
Okay.
Bring it. Bohemian Rhapsody.
I am a pretty good. I'm better than I was.
Okay.
You know, the
artist.
I'm a better artist.
Okay.
Than I was, but I've always been excited about it.
Okay.
And
to the point where you're edging.
Well, this was in college.
Okay, pre-edging.
So, pre-edging. Okay. I hadn't really perfected it, and I think even in college, I was probably, I may have masturbated, but...
If you see an ugly girl, is that called edge-hogging?
Oh, maybe, but I see beauty in all women.
Okay.
I don't even know the word ugly.
Okay, so keep going. You're in our class, and what the
hell
happened?
And it was a live nude model.
Oh... Boy or girl?
It was a woman.
So that would be girl was the answer
okay.
I was looking for.
Okay, I get confused about terms and he, she, girl, woman. I don't know. See the itch.
All right. No. Well, quell. So, it was
quell.
How do you spell it?
I believe K-W-E-L-L. But
sorry, go ahead.
Okay. So I just want my first art class. It was, I believe... A live nude or a life drawing. I'm not sure what the class...
A live nude, so it wasn't a cadaver.
It wasn't a cadaver. And let me tell you what happened.
Okay.
I was kicked out of the class...
Yeah.
...for doing a sketch of a student masturbating...
A lot of masturbating going on here today.
And it was...
Do you need to step out for a few minutes?
No, not at all. So they kicked me out of the class because the sketch was a student masturbating. It was a self-portrait, which I guess...
Of you.
Yes.
So you turned the nude around onto you.
Made it about me. And I had even tipped her. To pose in doggy style, because I'm not good with faces.
Oh, the model.
The model.
Yeah.
I had even tipped earlier to maybe maintain a doggy style position.
Like a cash tip.
Yes.
To change positions.
Yes. To start in that position and stay there.
So instead of the traditional just like this,
yeah.
You said, hey, here's 20. Can you doggy it up for me?
Yeah, because I'm not good with faces.
Right.
So and that, I think, sped up... The drawing and also the masturbation.
Wow.
I wasn't really an edger. I had to kind of help then because I think I was probably a chronic masturbator at 20.
What was the grade on that etching?
An incomplete, which is ironic.
You didn't finish.
I did finish, which I thought was ironic. I finished.
And they didn't give you a grade?
No. And here's what I did learn.
Assholes.
Which you'll appreciate this, because I'm a pretty good sketch artist. But you know who's really even better at sketch art? Police sketch artist.
Yeah.
Because a month later, he drew a picture of me at the window masturbating again.
There's that masturbation again.
Well, there is a theme.
Well,
and eventually I became an edger, but at the time in college, you know, you're just collecting units.
Are you edging right now, by the way? Because I'm getting a real weird...
Of course. I'm always close, man. And that's the juice of life.
Do you need some quell or anything?
I don't need anything.
Okay.
I am alive. I'm ready to go at any moment. If I bump into somebody, there's a chance I could nut... It's just life.
I want to tell you.
Eye contact.
Yeah.
I'm not attracted to you.
Well.
If you were Hugh Jackman, I would have already nutted a few times. And once again, that could be masturbation.
Yeah, I've always been, you know, good with the eye contact with you because I think it's important when you're communicating with a friend or a human in general. But now that I know you're an edger.
Yeah.
It's going to be real tough for me to look you in the eye anymore
but don't
when we talk. No, I think it's too late, maybe.
Don't change who you are.
Well,
can I ask you?
You changed who I am.
Okay, can I ask a serious question about you? Do you save your life force? Are you a masturbator? Do you have wet dreams? I have wet dreams, which is great at 50 years old or however old I am, almost 50, still having wet dreams. That's good living.
Well, the Bible says, thou shalt not spill thy seed. And I tried to live by that. And about 4 weeks ago, I feel so guilty. I was at Home Depot and I rammed my cart into a bag of grass seed and it just was all over aisle 27, the sprinkler aisle.
Yeah.
And I feel like now I'm going straight to hell. I spilled seed all over that Home Depot at Western and Vineland.
That. Yeah. Now, is that the seed that the Bible was talking about?
No, it was the Kentucky Blue, which is even worse.
Man, did you clean that up or?
They did. All you heard was clean up on aisle 5, seed. Someone spilled their seed.
I like that.
And a bunch of women came running around.
Are you in control of who you are? Or are you beholden to the weakness of masturbation? Do you save your chi, your life force, or are you weak?
Well, my story about that.
I'd love to hear it if I could.
About 3 weeks ago, I'm going through Home Depot, and I ram into a bag of grass seed with my shopping cart and spilled seed everywhere. And
I got to tell you, that sounds familiar. Where have I heard that?
Well, just trying to tell you where I'm coming from. But can I tell you a story about life nude drawing?
Of course.
That happened to me?
Yes.
This is real. So I went to animation college.
Okay.
Okay. When I was a student, I went to animation college.
Okay.
Twice a week, we had to do life drawing. Okay, we had to draw nudes.
So that's what it is called, though,
life drawing, it's called, yes. And okay. you draw nudes, they bring in models, people
yes.
who feel comfortable doing this, they get stripped naked. We'd do it twice a week. We'd stand in a horseshoe. There'd be someone on the stage, and we'd be in a horseshoe
wow.
shape around them. Like
like a circle jerk. You all right?
Sorry.
You got that itch.
Got to quell that itch.
I can't itch now without nutting.
But anyway, so we're standing around this model, okay? On this particular occasion, it's a skinny dude, like a
nice.
Skinny male, sort of sickly. Almost looked
nice.
A bit sickly.
So was this at medical school?
This was animation school.
Okay.
Where I went to college.
Got you. I lost that. When you started talking about how sickly he was.
He looked a little emaciated. And
okay.
Sometimes you wonder if these people are doing this because they get a few bucks, they don't have jobs. So it's
yeah.
like. So one of the things.
And that's less pencil.
Right. That's less a mass you have to draw.
Interesting.
So it makes it easier for us. But this was my second year.
Okay.
And one of the things they always taught us to get perspective is to hold up the pencil. You know, you've always seen this thing. You hold up your thumb or you hold up the pencil and it's supposed to give you a sense of perspective. And I always thought it was so pretentious.
Yeah.
I hated it, so I never did it. I never once did this to my nude models. Everyone else in class.
How close are you? Because I was two rows back.
Okay, we were probably.
Can you actually touch yours?
No, we're probably, I'd say 15 feet perimeter, 15 to 20 feet.
And this is you pick what part of her you want to draw?
Yeah,
you. Or him?
Or sick, him, yep. And you kind of do this, and you kind of, it's supposed to give you a perspective.
I should have done that at the orgy.
Yeah. Yeah, you should have.
My perspective was off, but next one, if it ever happens again.
You could do
so
that.
Go ahead. I'm sorry, brother.
No, not at all. And so this was my second year. Everyone had been doing this for almost 2 years.
Whoa.
And so I finally.
But did they stop to eat, or is it just a constant? For 2 years, someone's sitting like that?
Oh, no, I'm sorry.
Because that's why he's...
Right, that's why he was so weak.
Oh, if he's sitting there for 2 years, why he's sickly.
No, I didn't mean
he could have started off a linebacker.
That's right.
Okay.
No, he was. It was for 2 years, my course, and we'd have different models every week. Sorry.
I apologize.
I didn't explain it properly.
I also was just, you know, I do some forensic thinking.
Yeah.
So two years.
I didn't communicate it well, and I think part of that is because I don't like to look you in the eye anymore because you're about to squirt.
I know, but I told you you're not going to do it for me.
Well, I'm
leaking, but that's just who I am.
I can smell it.
Okay.
So now after almost 2 years, one day I go, I've never done it. I hate it. I hate watching the other students do it. This nude model standing there. And I go, you know what? I'm just going to do it to see what it's like. And so for the first time, I go like that. I have my little pencil. I go like that, and I'm holding it like that for about 4 seconds. And this guy just goes, fainted. He just fell over, fainted.
Because of what you did?
No, but the timing was, I went like this, and I'm like, I squint my eye, and the minute I do this.
So did you do this?
No, I didn't follow.
Oh, but why didn't you?
I was just in shock because I actually thought
so
after
you're not
2 years,
an artist.
It never happened. And I thought, fuck, it was me. You know, I was like,
so have you done it again to anyone?
No, I have never done it.
I kid. I joke. I didn't.
But isn't that funny?
Yeah. So he was sick.
I don't know. Maybe he was just needed some sugar or whatever. And my ex-girl.
What year was this?
Oh, this was in the early 80s.
AIDS.
Maybe it was the first. Maybe I started AIDS.
Yeah.
With this.
Was there a monkey around? Did he have a monkey?
Hold on a second. There was a monkey.
Okay. Do you have the drawing? I would love to see this picture.
I do have the drawing of the monkey. You're right.
But what about the guy? Do you have this guy? Because you can match it to the, there was a stewardess on a plane.
Yeah, it was an Air Canada steward. Yeah. It was a guy.
Was this him?
Oh, my God.
Was this in Canada? Your
this
art
was in
class?
Canada. Holy shit. I started AIDS. And you, who knew it was that?
Well, we worked on it together.
Now I do feel guilty. Remember I said I sort of felt guilty, but now I started a lethal disease.
Because if he had,
idiot. What an idiot.
Because when he passed out, they took him to a hospital and he infected everyone.
I feel like such an idiot for doing this.
AIDS started in an art class, but it started on a flight with a monkey, correct?
That's what I heard.
Air Canada.
Air AIDS.
Air raids. Do you hear that?
I do.
That's my ear tonight.
Oh, that's your tonight. It's really loud because I could hear it.
It got quiet.
It went real. I think it went to an 11 because I could hear it coming out of your head.
We learned a lot. How are we doing?
What do you mean?
We've learned so much.
Oh, should we start?
Yeah, let's start this.
Okay. Folks, we have Kirk Fox here, gang. We just had a little coffee table talk just to get the juices flowing.
Yeah.
Because we said we wanted to kind of ease you into it.
Yeah.
And I think we kind of just got
let's
there.
Let's start.
And let's start. My first question, Kirk, you're one of my friends who's got a spiritual side. You've got sort of an inner spiritual element to you that I don't find.
Get out of bed, stand on your head, take a deep breath, and say love. That's how I start every day.
Well, I wanted to fast forward to the end, and I wanted to ask you hypothetically.
Wait, the end?
No, I mean just
how
this,
are we doing
this,
on
this
time?
Question. This oh. question. Okay. Hypothetically. Kirk Fox, Rimmer.
How do I look?
Father Rimmer. Oh, you look great. You look
Rimmer.
Like a Rimmer.
An edger.
An edger.
I'm not really a
You look
Rimmer.
Like a Rimmer to me. Could you be both?
I don't mind a
could
rim.
Could you be edge trimmer?
An edge trimmer. That's good. I do. I have seen an edge trimmer in a homeless tent.
Oh, wow. Is it next to my lawnmower?
Yes.
Yeah, I figured.
So edge trimmer.
Yeah.
I do manicure the wood area.
You do?
I trim it down pretty good. And I use a straight edge.
Do the crabs get mad?
No, I do that just so they can get some sunlight.
Oh, God. So here's my question.
Okay.
Kirk Fox, who is a bit of a spiritual entity to me.
Well.
I know. I look at all my friends, and you're one of the guys that I go, There's a spiritual energy that burns in you.
Okay.
That not I all my
it
friends
burns not gonorrhea.
No, But all my friends have it, but you, I feel the essence of it more. So my question to you is sort of spiritual based.
Okay.
If Kirk Fox is, let's say hypothetically, lost in a desert, lost in the Amazon, his resources are dwindling, you're coming to the end, you're in one of those crawling, water, water. Do you reach out to God and talk to God, or did you just roll over and go, it's time to go?
Can I tell you something?
Please. Because we have started the podcast officially now.
You reminded me of a story that I hadn't thought about in a long time. But
I knew it.
When I was in my early 20s, I was even better looking, but more...
What?
But more young looking. I've grown into kind of an adult male. But in my early 20s, it was just straight up pretty.
Yeah.
But there was also that edge of, I always kind of looked hungry.
Edge,
but I was doing a Grand Marnier ad for Italy. And
wow.
I was crawling across the desert in search of water. And in the distance, I saw four beautiful women in red skin-tight dresses moving.
God.
I looked like a mirage.
Did you edge all over the desert?
This was when I was younger, before the edging took over. But one of them was Cameron Diaz.
Whew.
She'll confirm.
Yeah.
And as I got to them, I passed out. And then I was suddenly in a chair drinking Grand Marnier, and they were shaving me. And I was in a tuxedo now.
Wow.
Oh, and when I was crawling, I also had a bird cage with me.
Sure.
It was crazy. And they were shaving me, and I was drinking Grand Marnier. We were in the desert. It was hot.
Yeah.
Maybe 100 degrees.
Which desert was this?
Out toward Barstow area.
I thought it was in Italy.
No, it was for Grand Marnier. It was an Italian commercial.
I see.
We were shooting there. And then suddenly...
So it was the Mojave Desert.
Suddenly, I was being shaved, drinking Grand Marnier, and suddenly, I was on a teeter-totter. Very long. It was the length of a telephone pole.
Kind of like your penis.
Yes. And I was going back and forth. I was on one end, and the four girls were on the other end, and I was on a sandbag. And for some reason, I told the Italian director, I believe his name was Alberto Delardo.
Great director, by the way.
Or Umberto.
Great director.
I think Alberto Delardo.
Yeah.
And I said, I'm falling. And they said, we're getting the shot. We're getting the shot. And I slid off the end of the teeter-totter when the four girls were at the top.
Wow.
And when I slid off, they fell. And injured themselves.
Cameron, do you injured Cameron Diaz?
I injured her. At the time, she thought I broke the, what is the bone?
The coccyx?
The cock floor.
The coccyx, your tailbone?
Yes, but I think she thought I broke the vagina bone.
Oh, that one's tough to break.
There was pain,
too.
There was anger.
Yeah.
The commercial ended at that moment. But I don't think, did she have a baby recently?
Cameron Diaz?
Yes.
No.
Are you sure?
I heard she can't have him due to a teeter-totter accident.
I'd like to find out if she had a child.
If she did, it was probably in a playground.
Let me tell you this, because of the teeter-totter. If she did have a child, I'd like to just know that I feel better. Because for 20 or 30 years, I thought I broke her vagina on that teeter-totter. But did she have a baby? Cameron, I don't know if you watch this.
She does. She does. Hey, Cam.
Can you reach out to me and let me know if you had that child or did someone else have it? There's a way for other people to carry a baby, correct?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's called a surrogation?
Yeah, it's called a surrogation.
Okay, I'm just wondering if she gave birth or she and the rock star, one of the Madden boys, created a seed and put it somewhere else to grow.
Kentucky bluegrass. Is her kid green?
I'm not sure, but it was because you had mentioned crawling across the desert. So finish your question.
Well, I think I did, but I'll say it all over again. If you're at death's door.
Death's door.
You're crawling across the desert. And without the long, huge 20-minute detour to a teeter-totter
story.
Sorry,
brother. You just triggered something.
No, it's important we get it all out because I don't want you to rim. And so...
Edge, but rimming, not bad also. Nice to see you.
If you're right there, you're about to take your last gulp of water, you're about to take your last breath, does Kirk Fox reach out to a higher force? Do you go, God... I'm coming home, God, save me, God. Or does Kirk Fox just go, it was a good run, done. You do your last edge.
I've often said, and I've said this publicly, and I'll say it again because it matters.
Yeah.
If I had 4 minutes to live,
okay,
you can take me in two. I can get everything I need to do done in 2 minutes.
Wow.
If I'm face to face with death, I thank him. I take a deep breath and I say love. Love. And as long as you say love with your last exhale, it's a smooth exit. It's when you fight it and scream and cry. Just say thank you. Just say love. I've walked many people out.
You have.
When people die, I used to do this where I would comfort people and help them make their exit smoothly.
I have
that gift.
How many people have you helped help die?
Well, I wouldn't say murder because
they were close.
Hospice was there.
Really?
But I just talked them out of it gently.
Bob Hospice, one of my favorite actors.
Yes. So yeah, when they're at the edge between life and death,
I don't know if they want to be at the edge around you.
I nudge them to the end.
Last thing they
play
see is
nice
you.
Music, whatever they like to hear. I say,
really?
You're close. Your family's here. What do you see? Oh, do you see the ocean? You're walking toward the water. Oh, it feels nice. Touch that. Breathe it in. Ah, we're all gonna be okay. We're gonna miss you. You were great. This was nice. What a beautiful day.
How many people have you?
10. I think 10 I've been paid to assist.
You're paid to go in.
I'm paid to assist in death. Now, my wife's dad, I wasn't paid. I did it kind of on the house.
A freebie?
It was a freebie.
Why him?
Well, he was there. I was in the house when it happened. And I actually drove him down the driveway. He died on a Sunday. It was a high holiday, I believe, Judaism or something. A lot of people died on this day.
Yeah.
He died. I made it a nice exit. And then two old men came for the body.
Whoa.
They were close also to death. Two Jewish men from a Jewish funeral home. They came to get the body.
Yikes.
They zipped him up. They could not wheel him down the outdoor stairs.
Why were his pants down?
His pants were up, I believe. They zipped him up in a body bag. No, it's easy to get lost in today's conversation. We zipped him in a plastic body bag.
Okay.
We took him down the stairs.
Okay.
To the gate.
By the way, I never understood.
The top of his head hit the gate.
Oh.
He opened the gate. I had told my wife that it was his feet that kicked the gate open.
Yeah.
But it was really
his head
on the gurney. They got to the van. We put him in the back of the van.
Yeah.
And there was two other bodies in there.
Whoa.
They had double dipped. They had stopped to pick up two bodies.
Wow.
And then...
That's like when you order Uber Eats and they don't come right to your house. They do another delivery.
You're
assholes.
Absolutely right, Harlan. And then they couldn't back down the driveway. I drove the van down the driveway. Like Dexter. They waited for me at the bottom of the driveway. These two, they were almost 80.
Whoa. Maybe you should have just put them in the back. No one would have known
the
difference.
I'm not sure they both made it.
I don't think they did.
But at the bottom of the driveway, they wanted a tip.
Oh, God.
I did not tip them.
Yeah.
Because I felt I did the work.
Yeah.
And I didn't feel it was right to tip. It's like I did the driving.
You don't tip, they know who you are? You just said,
they should have tipped me. You tip the valet.
Yeah.
I backed that van down with two bodies in it. They wanted a tip. I said, no.
No.
And they understood. And then I went back upstairs, and then this hospice woman who was there with me, slowly giving a little morphine drip, I believe, which helped my story.
Oh.
She wanted a tip.
Jesus.
And I think I had to give her $50.
Don't they know you're the guy that broke Cameron Diaz's vagina?
Well, they're going to now. But I don't know if I broke it. I'd like Cameron. I apologize. But I'll tell you this.
Yeah.
She hadn't gotten Mask yet.
Okay.
She was about to audition for Mask.
Oh, God.
And she was nervous.
Yeah.
And I think because I broke the vagina.
Mm-hmm. So now you're saying you did.
I think she went in there a little happy to be alive because she played her. I said, just be yourself. Be the goofball.
I find
and she was, and she got Mask. And I think her whole career was jump-started because I had a little too much Grand Marnier.
Yeah.
I fell off the teeter-totter.
Broke her
the
vagina.
Other four women hit. I don't know what happened to the other three, but Cameron, I remember I broke the vagina.
Yeah. No wonder she got the Mask. I mean, nothing takes the edge off your nerves. You go into an audition, you're all tired, but when you walk in a room with a broken vagina, you got nothing to lose. You're going to get every audition you go in for.
She never really thanked me. I saw her over the years, and she was always friendly.
Yeah.
But,
just take her to a park.
Yeah. Cameron Diaz. Cameron, I hope the kid's great. Maybe you named it Kirk.
Or Crack.
Yeah. Broken Crack. Sorry. Go ahead.
No, this is our final segment with Kirk Fox. What an outing we've had, but we have to do it. Words from a Wooden Shoe.
And Harlan, I feel that I monopolized, but you led me down.
No, it was important we settled in for about 55 minutes before we got to the last four-minute segment.
Yes.
That's important, because if my guest's not comfortable, this doesn't work. And they know that.
I wasn't at first. You saw, because I felt betrayed.
You felt betrayed. You felt, I could see your nerves.
Like when you go in for FBI, DEA. Yeah. When you started a conversation, you want to know that they're recording.
It's got to be fluid. I didn't say what I should have said to calm you.
And you always do that. It's always kind of a rocky beginning here.
My bad. My bad, Rimmer.
Okay.
Edger. So what we do is we reach into the wooden shoe, pull out a word, and if something relates to your journey.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah.
And after what we've been through.
Well, it's a tradition at the show here. It's any story. It could be 3 seconds long. It could be whatever. Just
like an edge. It could be a quick
right on
quick
the edge.
Nut. Just I don't even want
to. Don't even look.
I'd like to go near the toes.
Yeah. Oh, wow. You're going deep.
Only because most people don't. I don't like to stick my hand where other people
do. Yeah. Oh, boy. What is it, guy? What do we got, guy? Here we go.
Drunkest ever.
Here we go.
Interesting.
It can be you, or it could be a friend, could be a relative, could be a stranger you saw.
I was thinking about this recently.
Here we go.
And because I'm not a big drinker.
Okay.
So it would never be the drunkest I've ever been.
Right.
But, wow. I would, in my early 20s, I used to teach tennis out in Port Washington.
Great place, great town.
And I'll tell you, this kind of ties in to everything. And it's making me laugh because only with you do I open up about some of this stuff, my friend. But I met a girl on the train, Harlan, and
I broke her vagina.
No. Oh, gosh. And we'd go on this train. I'd ride the train with her a few times. I would teach tennis out of Port Washington, and then I would take the train back to Manhattan, and I would catch the train up to the Upper West Side. I was staying with my sister during this time. I was actually training to be a professional tennis player, but I was teaching tennis at the time.
Okay.
And somehow, I don't know how it happened, but at some point, I got off the train to meet this girl once, and she had a car parked at the train station.
Okay, so no real reason for the train.
Well, I had to get there.
But she didn't. She had a car.
Yeah, this must have been her stop.
She was stupid.
I'm not sure all this, because it happened so quick. But somehow...
I think I'll drive my vehicle to get on another vehicle. Somehow, that's not a smart woman.
Somehow we got into the car.
Okay.
And there was intimacy involved between her mouth, I believe, and part of my manhood.
What inch were we at?
It started at the end.
Okay. And
not a lot happened before. She was drunk, I found out.
Okay, that helps.
Because she threw up all over my lap and the car and everything. And that might be the drunkest ever, but maybe not ever, but it's definitely the most memorable to have someone throw up on you. Because at first I thought it was me. I thought, wow, this is a hell of a load.
Whoa.
Hell of a nut.
But then you saw egg salad in it and realized it came from the other side.
But even when I saw the egg salad, I'm like, oh gosh, this is certainly chunky. And I was young, early 20s.
It's
so
chunky when you're younger.
So yeah. I wasn't really an edger. I think I was just excited to have met a girl and then gotten, oral pleasure.
Wow.
At a train
vomit,
station.
Really.
I think it was Roanoke, Long Island. Does that sound right?
Oh, I thought that was the flavor of ice cream all over your lap.
Ah, maybe.
Is Roanoke a
but
flavor?
But that's a pretty interesting...
Wow. Do you remember what kind of car it was?
I don't, but it may have been a Volvo.
Or a Volvo.
Maybe, but I think it was boxy.
Yeah.
And I was young. Always, when I'd get on the train in Port Washington, I'd get a big beer and a Kit Kat.
Wow.
So that was part of my my tennis training. So not a lot happened with my tennis because I believe my training was skewed.
Yeah, it's hard to play tennis when you're caked in vomit.
Yeah, but man, it's a memory.
Yeah.
Triggered by that shoe.
Yeah.
Man, Harlan.
Wow, good stuff. Well, Kirk, we want to thank you for being here on the Harland Highway. Anything you want to plug or mention before
I think I've talked about enough.
Yeah.
I don't.
Maybe too much even.
Really? Why? Life is short. I just poured it out. We had a good talk. These are things.
Yeah, you're right. There's never any filter
between
us.
A month ago you had mentioned art, and I said, maybe it'll trigger some memories.
Yeah, we never really even got to it. We did a little bit.
We did. We talked about life drawing and the nude model.
You know what I feel bad about, though?
Me getting kicked out of class.
We talked a lot.
And courtroom sketch artists are also good. Because eventually they drew me looking at the judge. So.
Yeah.
So I was a good artist, the police sketch artist, but the courtroom.
You're right. We talked a lot about art, and my only regret here is today that we didn't have time for any Garfunkel. But you'll come back.
I keep coming back. Do you have others?
You'll be back. Kirk's one of the fave guests here on the Harland Highway.
Boy, I hope this was educational.
It was educational.
And gentlemen, edge more. Just save that chi for your pants, and that way you can do more at the end of the night with your girl. She'll thank you. Keep on edging. And
ladies and gentlemen, you heard it from the rim master. Buddy, that
edge master.
Sorry. Buddy, thank you for being here. Folks, Kirk Fox, check him out. Go see him do stand-up comedy. Unbelievable. And that's it for today.
Okay.
We're all out of time. And until next time, everybody, be sure and call in and leave a voicemail, 323-696-0222.
Ask for Cameron Diaz. Let us know if she gave birth.
Let us know about Cameron's baby. And until next time, chicken chow mein, baby.
Thank you.
Wow. Do you need to go and release yourself?
No, I'm...
Okay.